Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to cover the basics of two more elements of Blender animation. The first one is called Shapekeys. So we've learned how to move objects around and rotate them and scale them and things like that. But what if we want to animate the change in shape of an object? Well, we do that with Shapekeys. So we're obviously creating keyframes that allow us to record the change in shape of an object. So if we start with our yellow cube here, and I'll go into edit mode, and I'll just add a few more vertices just to make it a little easier to modify its shape. Very important that you ensure that you apply rotation and scale with this sort of thing, because it can cause problems otherwise. So that's Control A and just apply rotation and scale. So if we come over to the properties of our object, in this case the cube, and you'll notice there's a section called Shape Keys. So under the Shape Keys section, I'm going to just click plus. I've obviously got my cube object selected. And initially, you get something called Basis created. So this is obviously the starting point of my object. We'll now click plus again, and we can create key one. So this is going to be the first distortion that we create. And we can just go with one, or we can have multiples. Obviously, to change the shape of my object, I'm going to go into edit mode, and I'm going to select some vertices. So alt right click, and I've selected the ring of vertices there. Just to keep things simple, I'm going to scale the middle layer out to here. And then I think I'll select these two vertices and scale them in like that. And you'll notice as soon as I come out of edit mode, the object reverts to the shape it was in. But you'll notice also we've got some other options here. And one of those is a value option. If I move this value option to the right, you can see we're getting an interpolated version of our shape there. So I think at this point I'm going to add some additional vertices. So I'll just select all the vertices and press W and say subdivide. And we'll go up to a couple of subdivisions just to make it a slightly smoother transformation. So now when we turn that up, you can see we're getting that shape distort into the shape that I created. So as you see, if I do this, we get our distorted shape, but we can have more than one shape key. So if I add another one and go into edit mode, I could perhaps select the corners, scale those in a little, perhaps go into proportional editing mode and scale those into there. So now I have a shape that does that. And because these are relative, if I go to key one and say turn that one up to full, then I go to key two, I can start to turn that one up, and you see that one's affecting it as well. And there's something else we can do with this as well. You'll notice we've got a minimum and maximum range. So by default, the min is 0 and the maximum is 1. So that's the maximum influence. So this slider will go from 0 to 1. 0 being none of the effect, 1 being all of the effect. So that is exactly the shape that I created with shape key 1. But I could set max to 2. You notice the slider obviously is only halfway along now. And if I use that, this is actually taking the vertices in the direction that I moved them, but it's taking them further than they went before. Twice as far. Alternatively, I could leave that at 1 and I could say the minimum is minus 1. So this will obviously allow for the vertices to go in the opposite direction. So there's 0 back to our original shape, and now we're going in the opposite direction. I'll set that back to 0, and I could do the same with shape key 2. So there it is going in the opposite direction to the one I took it in. And so we can get quite a set of combinations of shapes by putting these into different values. So we can also, of course, keyframe these. We're on the first frame, so I'm just going to press I while hovering over this value and do the same for keyframe 2. Then I'm going to come some way in, perhaps frame 25, so that's a second in, and I'm going to keyframe 2 again at 0. And again, the same for keyframe 1. Then I'm going to go up to frame 50 and I'm going to take keyframe 1 up to 1, and then perhaps frame 75, and I will take keyframe 2 also up to 1, keyframe that, and then perhaps all the way to 100, and we'll set them both down to minus 1 and keyframe that just by pressing I. So when I press play now, you can see we get the shape going through various iterations. And if I wanted it to be cyclic, I could perhaps put this at 125 frames for the end frame, go to the end, and obviously set these to zero and keyframe them. So now when I press play, there we go. So we've got a strange shape going through various iterations. And I could add a subdivision surface just to make it look a little more interesting and set it to smooth shading. So that's shape keys. Let's remove that shape now. And let's talk about bones and rigs. So I'm not going to go into all the complexities of bones, but I will show you a few elements of it. So bones can be used either to distort a shape or to connect various shapes together. So to begin with, let's just add another cube. And we'll scale it on the Z-axis just to make it a little taller. And I'm going to add an armature, which is a single bone. So there it is. That is a bone. That is the basis of a rig or armature. A rig or armature is equivalent to the sort of wires that they would put inside a puppet that's used for animation that allows them to pose it. So you can imagine the bone is being used to set the shape of the object within which it sits. You can't actually render bones. They're not visible when you do the render, but they are visible in the preview screen. So I put that bone in here. One of the first problems we've got is we can't see it. So the typical thing to do is to come to the armature properties, which you'll see when you've got a bone selected, this little person shape, and just click X-ray. And now it doesn't matter where the bone is, you can always see it. So we'll just make sure it's reasonably well aligned with the shape. We'll go into edit mode, make sure the tip of the bone is selected, and pull it up here. Now there are various different shapes of bones that you can use. This is a typical shape to use because it gives you a very clear indication of which end is which. And why that's important is, out of edit mode, if I rotate this bone, you can see it rotates about that lower end there. So back into edit mode, select everything, press W, and we'll say subdivide, and we'll say 3. So we've now got 3 bones within our object. Typically, you'll put your armature on another layer just to make things tidy so you can quickly switch between the bones and the object, or in Blender 2.8, that would be another collection. So we've got our armature. And we now need to in some way connect it to our shape, the shape that we want to distort. So I select my object, right click in Blender 2.7, it's actually left click by default in Blender 2.8. Select with shift held my armature, my bones, then control P, and you get a set of options. So this is like parenting that we did in the previous tutorial, but this time with some extra options. And you can see we've got armature deform, and we want one of those. Typically you're going to use with automatic weights, and we'll just select that and I'll explain in a moment what that's talking about. So in theory, we've now got our armature linked to our object. So I'm just selecting my bones, press G and move it around, and our object is moving around with it. So that's fair enough, we've parented it. When you've got bone selected, down here, you'll also have pose mode available. We select that. You can see we've got a blue outline around our bones. And I'm now going to rotate one of them. But immediately you can see things aren't quite working as we expected. You can see the bottom and the top of the shape seem to be connected to the bones, but it's not distorting the shape in the way that we planned. So I'll rotate that one. And again, so you can see the bones are joined. If I just select that top bone, just pressing G and trying to move it around, it actually rotates. So it's sort of doing something, but not quite what we expected. And the simple reason is because we don't have enough vertices in our shape. So if I come out of my edit mode on the bones, select my shape, go into edit mode, we've got vertices at the top, vertices at the bottom, but no vertices in the middle. So I'm going to select my object, come down to here, under parent, I'm going to say clear parents. That's going to remove the parenting. So if I select my bones now, move those around, you can see they don't have any effect on the object. I'm now going to select my object, go into edit mode, unselect everything, control R, and you can see we get a loop in the middle, and then use the mouse wheel just to add a few more loops. Probably don't need that many, but that'll be fine. Then left click and left click again. So that's added a few vertices that way round, and I'll add some this way, and this way. So that's added a lot more vertices to our object, and you need a certain minimum of vertices to be able to distort it. So I'm now going to hold shift and right click on the armature, control P, and we'll say again set parent to armature deform with automatic weights. Selecting my armature, I'm now going to go to pose mode again, and we'll rotate that top. And now you can see we're getting a more expected rotation of our object. It's actually distorting it. There are various options associated with how that works, but that's the basis of how an armature works. Distorts the shape to which it's parented. Now a little bit about weights. So if we look at this object, we've got the object itself selected, and we go to weight paint, you'll notice we've got something different happened here. So this is an indication of how much the vertices in this object are associated with, in this case, the first bone. Because when you have an armature in an object, the armature becomes selectable as well as the object itself when you're looking at weight painting. So if I right click on the middle bone, you can see this is the area that's most associated. And we can change that. So we've got a paint tool up here. I could say add, and I could increase the amount of selection here. If I now come out of weight paint, select my armature, which is still in pose mode, and rotate that, you can see that's just selected it a little more strongly. Gives us a slightly better distortion. So objects don't need to be one object, we could have several objects. So let's join these together, and we'll just say join. So this is now one object there. It's made up of four separate objects, but it's essentially one object. We'll add a bone, we'll set it to X-ray. We'll make sure it's roughly level with the bottom. I've selected the top part of the bone, and I'll come to about here. Now I press E, and then left click, and then pull the top up, and you can see we've got a second bone. E, left click, pull the top up, and E, left click, and pull the top up once more. So that's created four bones, each one is within a shape. We just need to move our armature to the middle of our object, at least roughly. Select our object, select our armature, Control P, and say with automatic weights again. So let's see what that did. I'll select my armature and go to pose mode and rotate the middle. And you can see it's very nicely carried out that as we would have expected it to. So that's made a nice simple shape. But how do we actually animate this? There's a lot of complexity to how you can use armatures. I'm not going to go into that level of complexity, but very simply, you can just record it the way you would any other object. So if I go to the beginning of the animation, I can select my armature, I can press I, and I get some slightly different options with an armature. And I could just say whole character. So I've got the bottom bone selected, press I, and I'll just say whole character. So this has recorded the rotations and relative positions of each of the bones. If I now come to, say, about frame 25, I can now perhaps rotate that bone that way, that one that way, that one that way. Press I and say whole character again, and then perhaps come to frame 50 and move them again. So if we play that animation, you can see we get something quite interesting. Now, something I haven't talked about so far is the dope sheet. So if I pull up a new window, we'll select the dope sheet. In Blender 2.8, it sort of combines that with the timeline down here. So the dope sheet is really showing for the object I've got selected, where the animation points are, where the keyframes are. But it also allows you to very easily copy parts of your animation. So Shift D with all of those selected and put more of them in. So let's see what we've got now. You see we've got more keyframes appeared down here. If I now press play, you can see it does that, and then it swings back and does it again. So that's a very simple way to control the keyframes. And of course, we can move them around up here as well. So if I right-click those, just randomly move some of them around, we'll get something slightly different happening now, because it's happening at a different time. There you go, you can see that. Before I delete the keyframes, I'm just going to go to the beginning and now delete the keyframes. That's another way to delete them other than Alt-I. And one last thing really about strings of bones like this, a very useful constraint that you can add to them. So come over to here, which is a little chain plus a bone, which is bone constraints, and we'll add a bone constraint. I've got this top bone selected at the moment, and we're going to add inverse kinematics. So this is about how one bone that is linked to another, how they influence each other. So I've just added inverse kinematics, and if I press G, you can see the whole thing is already moving, and there's even a little line there. If I remove that, you can see it just rotates it. But putting it back already, and I haven't even put any numbers or anything in yet, you can see just all I'm trying to do here is move it, and it's almost as though it's working like a finger, perhaps. So that by just moving that around, the other bones will move however they need to in order to get it to that position, if they can. Obviously, if we go try to move it beyond the point it can move, it just won't go. So if we look at chain length, if I put 1 on there, now you can see it's stopped doing it. It's gone back to how it was. If I now put 2, you can see it's doing it, but only down to that second bone. So that might be perhaps the hand and the elbow. And if we did 3, that would be the upper arm as well. But the shoulder might be down here, or the base of the knuckle, and that's not moving. And if I do 4, that will move as well. That will do the whole chain, because it's obviously all 4 elements are moving. And of course, we can animate that just the same. So I've got the top bone selected, and I'm going to press I and say whole character there. Move this bone to here. I, whole character. And now when we go back, we can see we get a nice movement all the way down to there. And of course, we can come to another frame, perhaps put it over there. Now you'll notice that we do get some interesting effects, such as the whole thing wanting to rotate in a particular direction. And you can sort of preset that by how you set the curve on here. But there are other ways to do it as well, using things called targets and pole targets. So if I just play that, you can see we've now got a little animation there. So I hope you found that useful. If you do, let me know, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.